When Jesus rose from the dead and returned to heaven undefeated, Satan knew that he was doomed. He was insane with fury. Jesus was now totally out of his reach. Now, if someone wants to hurt you, what's the best way to do it? Attack you physically or hurt you through someone that you love? Satan decided to get back at Jesus through the people Jesus loved, those he had left behind. First, he organized the persecutions by the Jewish leaders against the Christians, the followers of Jesus. Then, behind the scenes, he instigated the Roman Empire's slaughter of millions of Christians. On the star maps, a beautiful woman is depicted in chains, bound hand and foot, fastened down, unable to rise. The star names mean struck down, weak, the afflicted, the chained. Now in the Bible, the people of God are often depicted as a woman. Jealous rivals hate her, world powers are often employed against her. Innocently, she's made to suffer. By the world at large, she is hated. Throughout history, this has been the pattern. I recall that in Europe alone, for over 1,000 years, there was instituted an era of fierce persecution against the followers of Jesus. And at that time, every imaginable method of torture was used. 50 million or more true Christians were slaughtered for their faith. But this avalanche of terror was unable to extinguish their faith, because there was a promise of final victory, and that is going to be our next section. It is reported that when Hitler saw that he was about to lose World War II, he confided to one of his officers, "If I go down and Germany goes down, I shall drag the whole world down with me." So, as Satan's end approaches, he is working overtime to drag this world down with him. The final showdown looms before us, and here we see a lion, king of beasts, the sign of the Lion of Judah, King of Kings. Thoroughly roused, this lion is full of majesty. His name means he that tears asunder, that destroys, that leaps forth as a flame. The lion, associated with royalty and dominion, is fitted for the work of capture and destruction, so fierce and powerful that no other animal can withstand him. Star names in Leo mean the shining forth, the exalted, the judge or lord who comes with haste, the judge coming who seizes or violently takes, the feet which crush, the punishing or tearing of him that lays waste, and the putting down of the enemy. It is a deadly war, you see. He is also pictured as a mighty man who holds aloft the great sword in one hand and carries away the reeking snake-covered head of the enemy in the other. His name, Perseus, means the breaker. Names of his stars are he who breaks, who carries away, and who helps. The ancients understood him to be the son of the Divine Father, who would rescue the chained woman and destroy her enemy. The monster's snake-covered head has a star called Medusa, meaning the trodden underfoot. Other stars in this snake head are El Gol, the evil spirit, El One, the weakened, the subdued, and lest there be any doubt as to whom the severed head belongs, one star is actually named Rosh Satan, which means Satan's head. Jesus made a prophecy. He said, "There shall be signs in the stars.
The biblical prophets stated that as the end time draws near, the stars shall fall from heaven as a sign, like unripe figs falling from the tree when a strong wind shakes it. Now, this prophecy was strikingly and impressively fulfilled on the night of November the 13th, 1833. Over millions of square miles it was seen. The most extensive and spectacular display of falling stars ever recorded. Astonished eyewitnesses declared that never did rain fall much thicker than the meteors fell toward the earth. The whole sky seemed in motion. From 2 a.m. to broad daylight, it seemed as though all the stars were assembling at one point and simultaneously shooting like missiles to every part of the horizon, to the north, south, east, and west. Thousands followed thousands, hour after hour, as though created for the occasion. Careful scientific accounts indicate that more than a billion shooting stars appeared over Canada and the United States alone. Henry James Ward wrote the next day in the New York Journal of Commerce, "They flew, they were cast, like the unripe fruit, which at first refuses to leave the branch, and when it does break its hold, flies swiftly straight off, descending, and in the multitude falling, some across the track of others, as they are thrown with more or less force." The phenomenon was repeated and distributed over various parts of the world soon after. A correspondent in the New York Journal of Commerce, November 14, 1833, says, "No philosopher or scholar has told or recorded an event like that of yesterday morning. A prophet 1800 years ago foretold it exactly." The biblical prophet said that Judah's lion would bring on the falling of the stars. This is the prophet of John in the Revelation. And do you know the part of the sky from which that great shower of falling stars emanated? Perhaps I should let a scientist tell you. "The meteors," he says, "as seen by most observers, appeared to proceed from a fixed point in the heavens. Those who marked its position among the fixed stars observed it to be in the constellation Leo, in which it appeared stationary, accompanying that constellation in its diurnal progress." Did you get that? It is an astronomical fact that at the time prophesied occurred the most extensive and spectacular display of falling stars in history. Such an event, according to prophecy, was to be orchestrated by the Lion of Judah and would be as a warning, a signpost telling us that we were entering the last phase of man's history on earth. Now, here is a fact. This extravaganza did emanate from Leo, which is the zodiac sign of the judge who is coming to execute judgment and reign as King of Kings. Long ago, Satan had boasted, "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the sides of the north. I will be like the Most High." Now, what does this expression mean, "I will sit upon the sides of the north"? Friends, each night as the stars move across the face of the northern hemisphere sky, there is one spot that appears not to move. If you were to set a camera in super slow motion, you would be able to photograph this scene.